Thanks.
Eindelijk tijd voor discussie. Ik stel voor dat we de discussie in het Engels voeren, maar als u vragen wilt stellen in het Nederlands, geen probleem, dan vertaal ik ze wel voor Christian. Dus ik zou zeggen, shoot, wie heeft er een prominente vraag? Iemand? Niet? Kevin? En dat was met links.
Thank you for this great session. When you see a patient pre-op with a really disproportionate pain pattern, like widespread pain, would it change the surgical approach or delay the surgical approach? Or
what do you mean, Kevin? With the special pain due to?
Well, I think we all know the concept of central components in pain, central sensitization.
Okay, of course. When you treat patients, of course, you have to see the whole patient. When we do something on the knee, it's just something on the knee. And it's clear when pain is not only coming from the knee, but patients have some other problems, you have to tackle this. That's clear.
And does it impact the surgery? Does it have a negative prognosis on surgery outcome?
We know, let's say, for total knee, it's really well known. You can predict the post-op results on the preoperative psychology of the patient. So, of course, in HTO, when we want to go for fast rehab, the patient has to be prepared to go for this fast rehab. So this is also in sports with ACL, it's really well known. If you have the good patients with the good motivation and it's really active, these are the good patients. Patients who are afraid and they say, well, maybe this surgery is not good for me. You have to be careful, this for sure. And also for this kind of patients, we feel it's maybe better to go for prosthesis than for HTO, since HTO is, of course, in rehab a little bit more complicated.
Steph?
As a foot surgeon, I want to ask whether you also examine the foot, because sometimes we see that you put the leg straight and then the patient is coming to us complaining of his subtalar joint. Normally it will adjust, but if the subtalar joint is not flexible anymore and you put the knee straight, then I've got the patient's got a hind foot problem. And also in your measurements, you always cut off the foot.
It's funny because Christian and I, we were just 10 minutes ago discussing this issue. So, Christian, what's your take on this?
Yeah, ankle joint issues are, well, rather not seen in that patient group. We have like patient selection of 4,500 patients, and it's not that they come back and complain about subtalar or ankle joint problems. So it's really not something that we focus on a lot. Of course, it might be different. We were talking on subgroups of patients where you have a fusion, for example, or really severe osteoarthritis there, then you might assess that. And of course, you need to find out whether the correction is rather doing you a favor or the opposite. Sometimes, of course, for valgus patients where you have like a valgus alignment of the ankle joint, the limb alignment correction is really doing a good job there. So it really eases the problem of the ankle joint. One should not really exclude it. You always need to look at your whole patient. I mean, it's not just the knee that sits in front of you, but it's not that big an issue. So.
And what about the? Sometimes they come to me first with a foot problem, and the knee is not well aligned. You agreed to first align the knee and then see what we do with the foot. I mean, that's what I.
Well, you could do that, of course. There is like this supramalleolar corrections that you can make. Beat Hintermann from Switzerland is making some quite a lot of these, actually. So you could think on that, of course. And you have all the options of closing and opening wedges there. So the other way around, I would assume that might be, if you're a foot surgeon, that might be the best answer. Because the other way around, we know that the ankle correction, of course, doesn't affect the knee a lot. So the lever arm that comes behind is not long enough to have really good effects there. But if you have still complain about, or the patient still complains about the ankle joint, then of course you have have another choice for a correction there.
But I think, Steph, you have a good point. Since we see on standing x-rays post-op, especially with the bigger corrections, there's frequently a nice inclination of the knee joint, but you see, oh shit, there's something happening at the ankle joint. And you see there's a valgus in the ankle joint without today, as we know, clinical implications. But this says something I feel to be studied in the future.
Maybe in the future, 3D standing CT scans with, we can do it now for the foot and the ankle, and I think in January it will be go up to the knee, so you can see and the knee and the foot and the subtalar joint standing on a CT scan. So maybe that will be a solution.
You see me smiling because we have not even solved all the problems for just the frontal plane of the knee. So, I mean, we are throwing like bunches of things here together and try to have the big shot, you know, like the big puzzle piece that solves all the problems. We just know very little, huh? We have the oldest science and we are just at the very beginning.
Again, one for Christian. I was a little bit intrigued in Tone's lecture by the discrepancy between the numbers in the US going steeply down and our own numbers of HTO going up. You work in a center which is very well known for osteotomy. How is the evolution in your center comparing HTO with, for instance, uni? And do you have the same increase in numbers? Or?
So the question was then the development on figures in our center that we've had. Well, when I joined that section, we already had quite an established osteotomy center because Philip Lobenhofer made a great job in adopting that and really taking care for that renaissance of osteotomy that we have. So that was always there. We had emerging number of unicondylar prostheses when I joined that group, but that got more and more. So on the other hand, it didn't really cost our osteotomies because that's a different subgroup of patients. As I try to, I mean, time is always short, but I try to show you that there is a difference whether you have a metaphyseal deformity in your proximal tibia or you have wear, which causes the malalignment of the knee. So if you have a varus, there might be many, many options for that. But if the joint really is the problem, if you have an intra-articular problem, then the patient is rather suitable for unicondylar replacement, and if the metaphyseal deformity causes rather this osteoarthritis that might later on and progress and lead to full thickness defects, then the HTO is rather the solution. So it didn't cost our osteotomies to lift up our figures for unicondylar replacements. And then over the last couple of years, because maybe it has to do with the fact that patients get older, we see more and more like the so-called rotten knee. So our figures of total knees are rising. And now overall, we make like one third of each. So okay. We have like 300 osteotomies, 300 unicondylars, and 300 total knees. And which, that differs over...
Which is still a quite a big percentage of HTOs. When you compare to...
Well, I consider that to be quite... You could argue the other way around. So, of course, if you look for the international figures that we have, and you see really raising figures from your perspective, it's like that, for total knees, with this industrialization of knee surgery, and we have like a constant level of osteotomies, which is going quite low now, and we have a basic low level of unicondylars back from the 70s. That had to do with this Kozin and Scott criteria, who found out that unis are not for the obese, not for the elderly, not for this and not for that. And so you end up with like 1% of your patients that you can treat with a uni. And once you never do that, you don't gain experience. When you don't have experience, the results are inferior. And so therefore you treat everyone with a total joint because this is what you have. That's a little bit the problem. If you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And we need to put some other tools here again. That's it.
Some more questions? Okay.
That is it. Oi. Was I've got one eye. Maybe a question for Stephen. Did you try the effect of an unloaded brace on young people with constitutional varies on the timing to perform an osteotomy? When they have a varies and you put them in an unloaded brace, is the timing to perform an osteotomy postponed or not? Or didn't?
You mean in symptomatic patients or in asymptomatic patients?
Yeah, I have a lot
of. So constitutional varies, something 30% of this room has, myself included. So that doesn't mean that everybody has having knee complaints at the medial side. But I think if you start having knee complaints with the constitutional varies, the wearing of a brace is can be super interesting. And I'm sure a lot of our patients who come with a varus knee, constitutional or not, are so happy with the brace that they just don't come back. And we see them in 4 months and they say, I'm fine, thank you, cheers. And they come in 2 years for a new brace. I have plenty of patients like that who just decide, I wear this brace when I do this, this, and this. And for the rest of the time, I don't need it. Just like a tool. We have plenty of patients, and for this, of course, I think it postpones surgery. And that's also what the study I showed you tells. So it can really help a patient to get better as a therapeutic tool, and in some patients, especially who dislike the brace, because that's the most disadvantaged thing about the brace, that you have to wear it, otherwise it don't work. But wearing a brace is a pain in the ass for most people, especially for women. They don't like it, they think it's ugly, and that's how it is. So the most people come and say, the brace is awesome, but I want to get rid of it. That's the most common reason to do an osteotomy, I think. I just have one question for Christian as well, because sometimes we suffer with patients who come in and they say, listen, my knee is degenerated, I have arthrosis, and somebody, my doctor or somebody told me to get a new knee. And then we have often difficulties try to explain to the patient that maybe an osteotomy is the best thing to do and not the total one he came for. So sometimes they're really disappointed that I don't want to give them an osteotomy. So my question to you is, Christian, what is your trick? How do you sell osteotomies to a patient? How do you tell them, no, listen, this is the best thing? Do you have any advice for us?
Yeah, good question. So I don't try to persuade them first, of course. I mean, they come with an opinion, and that opinion basically is based not on their own ideas. It's something that they might have read on the internet. Some physician might have sent them to us, and so they are faced with that, and they just know the total knee. That's it. So just like with you, our job is to open that new world for them and to show them that there are alternative pathways. That doesn't necessarily mean everything is decided and they are suitable for that. But once they are suitable, then of course I can offer them something. It's like this old Staubli saying, give the patient another good 10 years. And of course it's way better to maintain your own knee than to just replace it. I mean, we know that, we have seen that today now in the talks before. The results of total knees, especially in that age group amongst till 55 years of age, we know that from new data from the NHS, more than 40,000 patients included, and we know that under the age of 55, there is a revision rate in the first 5 years of 30%. It's a disaster, to be honest. So we cannot offer these patients really a total knee and think everything is safe and sound. It's not, of course. So we need to have something else in our portfolio, and this is why we offer, I guess, an osteotomy. But I always tell my patients there's one good and one bad thing about an osteotomy. The good thing is you keep your own knee, and the bad thing is you keep your own knee. So of course it's partially destroyed, but if you get the mechanics in the right way, then it might work for another 10 years, and I guess every one of you would say, well, I'd keep my own one. Let me add one more thing. Sorry, it's all the data that we have concerning osteotomies and the survivorship of osteotomies is quite old. There is numerous techniques that that really went into these studies that we have, even in the meta-analysis that we have, different techniques that came to that outcome. So we don't yet have a good study showing long-term data on new techniques of osteotomy, really superior techniques. And even the old studies that we have show that we have equal results in comparison to arthroplasty or unicondylar replacements. So if the results right now are already with the poor techniques of these old studies that went in there, if the results right now are already better, why shouldn't we have the strong belief that it will be even better in the future of osteotomy?
Ja, ik ben kinesitherapeute. Ik woon iets verder af. Ik ben ongeveer 30 jaar in de praktijk. Ik heb in mijn praktijk nog nooit iemand gezien met een osteotomie. Komt dat of ligt dat aan mij of ligt dat aan mijn omgeving? Als dit.
So she said she's a physiotherapist living a little bit further and she's been practicing for years, but she never saw an osteotomy in her practice. And so the question is if it's her fault or.
als dit goed werkt, het is toch, we hebben niet zo'n groot land, waarom kunnen ze dat dan niet in mijn omgeving?
Wel, ik denk niet dat ze dat niet kunnen, maar er zijn een paar bemerkingen en misschien dat mijn pa daar ook op wilt filosoferen, maar ik ben zeker dat er een paar issues zijn die spelen bij zowel patiënt als bij chirurg. Patiënten hebben niet graag dat je zegt, ik ga je been doorzagen en rechtzetten. Dan hebben die zo'n gezicht zoals ik dat heb laten zien in mijn lecture. Dus de patiënt heeft natuurlijke angst en die wil gewoon binnenkomen en die zegt, pak mijn slechte knie eruit en zet er een nieuwe in. Zo redeneren veel patiënten. En twee, ik denk dat een osteotomie wel een procedure is die sommige chirurgen ook angst inboezemt, omdat het technisch iets moeilijk lijkt en een verhaal heeft van veel complicaties te kennen. Maar de derde reden is misschien nog veel interessanter. Ik denk dat er ook een belangrijke industriële aspect aan zit. Je moet weten dat implantaten voor knieprothesen verkocht worden door firma's die daar massa's geld aan verdienen. En dat een firma, denk ik, zeker preferentieel een implantaat voor een prothese verkoopt dan een simpel plaatje met een paar vijzen. Dat maakt voor een firma een gigantisch verschil. Dus ik denk dat de commerciële drive achter het vervangen van knieën niet te onderschatten is en dat te veel chirurgen ook worden getraind in replacement. So I'm explaining that I think that.
I got everything. So okay. Flawlessly in Dutch.
Dus ik denk dat dat een derde factor is die vaak wordt onderschat, maar waar daar iedereen, elke chirurg, onbewust wel, laat ons zeggen, slachtoffer van is, dat de industrie ons zegt, dit is eigenlijk voor te vervangen. En ik denk als we ons punt kunnen hardmaken en op binnen enkele jaren onze reeks kunnen tonen, dat misschien wel een manier is om aan de overheid te zeggen van hey, we moeten eigenlijk meer osteotomie doen, is veel goedkoper en je stelt een operatie 10, 15 jaar uit. Zoiets.
Gaan universitaire ziekenhuizen daar ook in mee?
Ja, opnieuw, het is echt niet de bedoeling om de rekening te maken van andere centra of collega's. Ik kan alleen vaststellen dat wij in ons ziekenhuis ongeveer 20% van alle osteotomies in België doen.
Mm-hmm. What brought us there? I mean, this is the general perception. I completely agree with Steve, but the problem is what brought us there, that we all think putting in a total knee is quite easy and just making one single bone cut, or maybe two if you make it biplanar, is very difficult. Isn't that ridiculous? I mean, we know that the data is completely in opposite to that. The data, we have quite weak outcomes for total knees in young patients. And of course, it's a very difficult and complicative surgery. Well, it's way easier to perform an osteotomy if you do it the right way. So what's the deal here? And I think that the commercialization of it and industrialization of total joints is one key factor. I mean, as we've hadn't had those some 50 years ago, up to the first natural knee, there was no doubt that patients are treated with an osteotomy. But we had nothing to maintain the corrections that we had. So they were treated in plaster of Paris. That was it. But even that went well. So It cannot really be an excuse that that total joints are easier to implant. I mean, people think that every monkey could implant it. It's ridiculous. So we need to go a little back to what our roots were. I mean, our signe is a bent tree, and we try to keep things aligned. And now we just gave all our work and capacity of correcting things away to the industry that dictates the business. So, might be something to think about.
One final question, maybe? Somebody? No? Then we can close the meeting.
Okay, then the final remarks. Iedereen bedankt voor de komst. Het is ons, de mensen die het langste blijven, dat zijn de echte. Dus ik hoop dat jullie van een dag wat genoten hebben en wat opgestoken hebben. Wij vonden het alleszins enorm interessant. Ik moet je een paar zaken meegeven. Eén, je kunt alles nog verder bekijken op de website. We hebben een livestreaming. Je gaat daar, of je hebt het al gekregen, een code voor krijgen. Dat kun je een gans jaar bekijken nog. Twee, je gaat ook, iedereen gaat ook denk vanaf maandag al een enquête ingevuld te krijgen. We zouden heel graag hebben dat je dat invult. Wat zijn onze goede punten, wat zijn onze sterke punten? We gaan ook vragen, een beetje meer in het Engels, is dat goed, is dat niet goed? Het voordeel van wat meer Engels is dat je meer buitenlandse sprekers kunt vragen en het niveau verder opkrijgen. Ik wil jullie bedanken voor de komst. Ik wil natuurlijk al onze medewerkers bedanken. Ik moet hier Philippe Bataille bij betrekken, want die is hier vandaag niet. Die zit in Chili op een hulpcongres, maar die heeft dat echt mee goed gesteund, samen met Philippe van Mitjo daar. En ik denk dat Philippe nu aan het meekijken is op de livestream. Dus, ik bedank uiteraard alle mensen van de companies die ons geholpen hebben en die met hun stand daar staan. Alsjeblieft, wil er even passeren, want zonder die mensen is dat compleet onmogelijk, dat verhaaltje hier. Ik nodig jullie bij deze ook uit voor volgend jaar. Hebben we al een datum, 20 oktober. We hebben zelfs al een topic. En dat topic zal zijn, het is toch een sportcongres, maar het gaat een hele brede visie zijn op wielrennen. Dus maar alles nog wat met wielrennen te maken heeft, van kop tot teen. Dus save the date. We nodigen u allemaal nog uit voor een hapje en een drankje. Bedankt om erbij te zijn en kom allemaal nog lekker goed thuis en geniet van de zon. APPLAUS